Our hymn of celebration this morning is hymn number 218. Please stand as you are able and join us in singing.
Thank you.
as we unite in the confession of our early church.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Seated. It's my pleasure to invite the Vance Smith family at this time to come and lead us in worship through the lighting of our Advent wreath. You'll also notice a congregational choral response to sing in just a moment.
Not be afraid. Salvation is at hand. God is about to do a mighty thing. Joseph's dream of God's promise will soon be our reality. God's promised Messiah will be none other than Emmanuel, God with us. We light the fourth Advent candle in hope of the coming of Emmanuel, God in the flesh. God's healing of human brokenness comes by way of God taking on human flesh. Come, Lord Jesus. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen.
We light this candle as a symbol of the Prince of Peace. May the visitation of your Holy Spirit, O God, make us ready for the coming of Jesus, our hope and joy. O come, Emmanuel.
Thank you, guys.
At this time, I'd like to invite Brett and Catherine Kaufman to come at this time with their son, William. William is the grandson of Mr. and Mrs. Kenneth Kulik, Mrs. Mary Kaufman, and Mr. and Mrs. Donald Kaufman. So Brett and Catherine, as you bring William before us for baptism, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, answer, I do. And do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression, and whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do. And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, answer, I do. And will you nurture William in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, he may be guided to accept God's grace for himself, to profess his faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, answer, I will. Now, you have a part to play in this, as well as members and representatives of the church universal that sits under Jesus Christ. Do you renew your faith in God and place your trust in Jesus Christ as your Savior, and place your whole trust in his grace for salvation? If so, answer, we do. And will you nurture William in faith by loving and caring for him? And will you do all in your power to increase his faith, confirm his hope, and perfect him in love? If so, answer, we will. What name is given to this child?
William Edward.
Come here, buddy. Yeah. Oh. William Edward, I baptize you now in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May God's grace and mercy rest upon you all the days of your life. Amen. You would turn with me to hymn number 191, Jesus Loves Me.
Prepare our hearts for prayer.
Old Testament, Father, we know points to something magnificent. The New Testament writers of letters point back and refer back to the gospel message and the story. And we know, O God, that during this Advent season, it's easy to miss the why of Christmas. We know, O God, that it's your desire and your intentions to deliberately offer an invitation to restore our relationship where we have broken it through disobedience. And we know, O God, that what we have been told and what we have read and what we have experienced is that in deep within us is this need to fill something that we inherited from Adam and Eve. There's something out there better. That this strive and this push and to attain something that is outside of ourselves that's better. To actually, O God, to hear that invitation home. We know, O God, that this Christmas story that we have heard, we have read about, and we have celebrated for years, can become something, O God, as a reminder as we prepare. And we pray, O God, once again, that our hearts would be filled with that anticipation that Simeon and Anna felt, and that the Old Testament prophets pointed to, that just gave that declaration and that reminder that God is going to do a mighty thing. May the Prince of Peace whisper into our soul that we are yours and you are ours. All this, O God, we ask in the name of your Son, who taught his disciples to pray this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Our hymn of preparation is hymn number 217. Please stand as you are able and join us in singing.
Thank you.
worship God with the giving of his tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Receive these, O God, your tithes and our offerings, and allow them to be multiplied for this church so that we may be able to further your kingdom and hasten your return. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Verses for this morning. First from Matthew. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem asking, "Where is this child who has been born the King of the Jews? For we observed his star at his rising, and we have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. And they told him, in Bethlehem of Judea. For so it has been written by the prophet, "And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are you by no means least among the rulers of Judah? For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel." And then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time when the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for this child. And when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." And when they had heard the king, they set out, and there, ahead of them, went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. And when they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. And from the Gospel of Mark, he called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If anyone to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel, they will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and yet forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
I welcome you once again, members and visitors alike. We're so very glad that you're here with us. There's a red pew pad at the center aisle. If you don't know what to do with the red pew pad, just ask your neighbor. They'll tell you. And if you would greet one another as the children come down for our children's sermon, we would appreciate it.
It is a map. You're right. It is a map. I want you to look. Do what? All right, hang on. Let's give one to your brother. There you go. All right. You see they've got 2 points listed, right? You see those little dots on there? Yeah, one of them is in the United States where we live. And you know where the other one is? Does anybody want to take a guess? Okay. That's America right there. And there's another place on the map that's all the way across the globe in a place called Ukraine. Yeah, that's right. You see that other dot?
I have seen it.
Mr. Bergen, would you like one? It's all the way across. You see that, guys? Let me get where I can see y'all. All right. See, this is where we're at, right here. And then all the way over there, and it says it's a little over 5,700 miles away from us. But it actually takes almost about two and a half days to get there. And you know who's going there here soon? Mr. Matthew and Miss Tammy. And they're going to go and be over there for about 10 days, 2 weeks. And they're going to represent you and all of us over there in Ukraine. And so one of the things we want to do this morning is we want to pray for them. So I'm going to ask Matthew and Tammy to come kneel. at the altar, and I want you to gather around them. Can you gather around Mr. Matthew and Miss Tammy with me? All right? You can gather around them. You can put your hands on them and touch them. Now, Miss Tammy won't bite, but I promise you, Mr. Matthew, I don't know. All right, let's get close to them, all right, guys? And we're going to pray for them to have a safe trip. Can you come with me? Does everybody want to come? Come on, y'all ready? All right? Somebody want to come stand by me? All right? Ooh, be careful. All right? Shh. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray for them, okay? So I want you to bow your heads. Close your eyes, okay, guys? And let's pray. You ready? Oh, God, what we ask is that you would watch over Matthew and Tammy in a number of different ways. What we pray, Lord, is that as you continually prepare their hearts to be your hands and your feet at times, sometimes to be your words, maybe your face, continue to do that work among them, oh, God. We want to pray for their safety in every aspect of this trip. We want to pray, God, that for those young boys and girls, and even the men and women that they'll come in contact with, that they'll see that it will do a couple of things, that it will be one more reminder of your love and grace in their life. It will be one more reminder of your care for them. So use us, oh God, we pray. We also pray for us that will be here, Lord, that in these days while they're over there, that you will burden our hearts to continue to pray, that you would burden our hearts to be in solidarity with them. Watch over those who live in these orphanages that we are in ministry with, we're in partner with, that are part of our larger family. Convey again your great work in Jesus Christ, O God. This we humbly ask, O God, we pray now in the name of Christ. Can everybody say amen?
Amen.
All right, good job, guys. Join me in prayer. Oh God, as we As we look at these texts, and the echo of the reading is still present among us, O God, we pray that the text would bury itself deep down into the depths of our souls and bring about transformation from the inside out, O God, we pray. And we ask this in the name of Christ. Amen. Now, Jack Campbell on Christmas Eve is sitting in his office and he's soaking up the fact that he's just inked about a $150 billion deal, where as a Wall Street executive, he helped pull these two companies together, where one was buying out the other. And so he sits in his Manhattan office about 50 floors up, just relishing everything that's taking place. And his assistant walks in and says, you've got a message from this woman named Kate. And immediately Jack becomes very reflective and he says, oh, she was my college sweetheart and I have not spoken to her in over 13 years. And his assistant says, well, should I call her back? Says, no, that's okay. And he leaves the office late at night. It's probably maybe 8:30, 9 o'clock on Christmas Eve. And he's so excited about this latest deal that he's walking home from his office with this feeling of accomplishment. And he walks into this convenience store and there to buy eggnog. And this guy that's sort of sketchy looking comes in and it's not long before the guy that comes in, sketchy looking, pulls out this gun, and he's getting ready to rob the convenience store. And Jack sort of steps in the way and trying to broker some level of peace, and it works. And he and this sketchy looking fella leave the convenience store, and they walk out into the street, and they begin to have this conversation. And Jack looks over at the guy and says, what can I do for you? How can I help you? And the guy starts to laugh and he says, I'm the one here to help you. He says, maybe I should be asking that question to you. How can I help you? And Jack says, there's nothing that I need. He kind of takes this little self look. I've got everything that you could ever imagine. I'm not the one in need. And before they depart, the sketchy-looking guy says, now, remember, Jack, you asked for this. So Jack goes home, and it's this wonderful penthouse up by Central Park, and he goes to sleep on Christmas Eve, and he wakes up Christmas morning, not in his penthouse, but in this house out in Jersey. And he's not alone. He's married now to his college sweetheart. They've been married for 13 years. They have two children, a daughter and then a son. Gone is his job as the leader of a brokerage house. Gone is all the things that come with that. Gone is his life, his wealth, everything. But his life is filled with all types of love. The love of this woman, and they are desperately in love. The love of his children, really the envy of all the neighborhood. This is the movie, The Family Man. Now, in this movie, it's real similar to It's a Wonderful Life. Many of you have seen that during Christmas. You got George Bailey, and George Bailey gets a glimpse of what Bedford Falls would be like without George Bailey. And so you sort of get the what if on the negative side. Well, The Family Man is the opposite of that. Jack Campbell gets the what if that 13 years ago when the movie opens, if he would have turned down this one-year internship at a bank in England, and if he would have stayed with his college girlfriend, what their life would be like. And in the beginning, it's a little fish out of the water. He still thinks that he's high-powered, hotshot executive on Wall Street. And so he's making all kinds of errors. But by the end of the movie, he's clinging to now this new life, which is nothing more than a glimpse or a dream. Now, some of you know that throughout this Advent that John and I have been using different Christmas movies. Some of them are spiritual, some are not. This is not one that is. It's PG-13. You need to know it's probably more for the parents than it would be for the young children, but it has a lot of merit. And like movies, there are things in our culture, in our society, that can be used sort of like a parable. That's what Jesus did in his day. Whenever he would preach, whenever he would teach, he would look for things that people would just know, that they would be used to, and he would unpack those in a way that somehow they could be harnessed to maybe teach something about the person that's listening to Jesus, maybe about someone else, or maybe about God, and that's what we've been doing. And today, we're going to use this movie that's about 15, 16 years old, The Family Man. Because there are some themes that come out of this movie that are interesting for us, particularly when it comes to who we are, how we see ourselves, how we see other people, how we might even see God. And one of the themes that is very present in this movie is this whole concept of how sacrificial love and commitment are tied together. See, Kate, that's his college sweetheart. Kate lives a life of sacrificial love and commitment to Jack when Jack even loses track of who he is, questions who he is, questions who they are. And so what Jack learns from Kate is this lesson of how commitment in life can lead to all types of joy. And this commitment in life is fueled by a sacrificial love. A number of times in the movie, whenever they're faced with decisions to make, Kate has this saying where she says, "Jack, if we have to do this, that's fine. But because if I have to choose between walking down this road and walking with us, I choose us all the time." And in the beginning of the movie, Jack he's frankly not a nice guy. He's controlling. He lives with unchecked ambition. He lives with unchecked a sense of self. And what he learns all throughout the movie is that from watching Kate, what's modeled by Kate, which is this sacrificial love that leads to her commitment, it actually thaws him. And he really becomes a person. Now, the teaching in the New Testament, when you look at the whole of the New Testament, what we define over and over and over is that Jesus is the model for us. Actually, that's what Hebrews says, Hebrews chapter 12. Jesus actually is the author and the finisher of our faith. And then that very next verse, after it gives that title to Jesus, the very next verse is a list of the ways that Jesus sacrifices for our benefit. So think about it. You got the beginning, incarnation, you got his ministry, and then eventually comes betrayal, becomes death, becomes resurrection, all types of sacrifice. And yet somehow it leads to joy, salvation. And so in this movie, in a very limited way, we see how one person's sacrificial love, commitment, ends up saving another person. How much more for us when it comes to Jesus? Not only is there this theme of sacrificial love and commitment that's tied together, there is this sense of fear that rules Jack's life. Everything for him is about winning. Everything for him is about somehow putting himself over someone else. And so he drives people that way. He drives himself that way. And he can't even see the collateral damage that it's causing to him, the damage that it's causing to other people. And fear can do that for us. Fear can be a huge influence in our life. But yet he's loved by this one. He learns what love is. He learns how to be loved. And it ends up changing him from the inside out so that he wants to reciprocate. He wants even to love that way. You know, in the New Testament, it talks a great deal about love. And one of the best descriptions is perfect love does what? What does it do? You know it. Cast out fear. And this influence that is knee-deep in our society, that pushes us, that wants to influence us to walk down paths that ends up leading to destruction, even for ourselves, for our bodies, for other people, for our relationships. There's something to where we find ourselves in the presence of God, where His perfect love has a way of pushing that to the sides. Being loved that way, let me ask you a question. What's more freeing than when you know of all your imperfections and someone else is aware of them as well? And at the same time, without cajoling, without control, and even without being prompted, they love you unconditionally. You know how freeing that is? I mean, we live in a world that measures itself on production, that measures itself on how you can distance yourself from someone else. And yet when you find yourself in the presence of God, it's perfect love casting out fear. It's not that we hide those things from God. He's fully aware of it. And He loves us still, because that's His nature. Now, one of the texts that John read from you, from the book of Matthew, tells a story about Herod's interaction with the Magi. Herod's life was dictated by fear. He also was not a nice man. He actually makes Jack Campbell in the movie look like a saint. Herod was known for murdering all types of folks. He murdered his sons. He murdered his brother-in-law. His brother. He later on, after this text that John read, if we were to follow that story all the way out, when the Magi return and they don't come back through Herod's palace, Herod finds out that they've sort of kind of pulled an end around on him. And so just to cover his bases, he goes into all these surrounding villages and he murders all the boys that would be close to the age of Jesus and younger. This guy's life was knee-deep in fear. Now, he wouldn't call it that. He couldn't see it. For him, it was about power. It was about prestige. It was about those things that he could distance himself, maybe be over other folks. But it's amazing how we can't see those things when we live our life in fear. Early in the movie, when Jack is still thinks he's this Wall Street hotshot guru, and he's playing with his daughter, and his daughter knows that it's really not him. Something's not right, and she looks at him, and in just an uncanny way that a little child sitting across a table with the father and says, "You're not here, are you? Something's missing. You're not my daddy." Because she knows that's not him. And then one of the last scenes of the movie, he and his daughter, same dad, same daughter, are playing out in the front yard in the snow, and he sort of falls back, and his daughter lands on top of him, and she says, "I knew you would find your way back. I've been waiting for you." He's changed, see? He's loved into wholeness. What was this isolated, controlling, when at all cost individual melts away in front of this family that loves him unconditionally? And when he has to go back, because he's been given only a glimpse of what it could have been, he's clinging to what he now has. So much so that he would gladly sacrifice the life that he has created in order to embrace that life with his family. It's amazing what love can do. Not just any love. A divine love. A love that is beyond anything that we can ever fathom. And that's the love that God offers in Jesus Christ. There's one other thing. It has to do with purpose of life. Jack thinks his life is about winning or being able to have the most compared to everybody else. You know, it's amazing how all the movies during this season seem to deal with this particular theme. You know, what is it about this time of the year that we are confronted with real purpose of life? You know, some of you study with us on Wednesday nights, and often we'll use a guy by the name of John Ortberg. And John Ortberg wrote this really just short, fantastic book that has to deal with shadow missions. And he's not the only one to talk about it. Actually, Jesus in the Mark text talks about it where when it comes to purpose of life, it has to do with seeking the kingdom. It has more to do with giving yourself to that than it is receiving anything else. And Ortberg, taking some of the teachings of Jesus, says that when we don't understand and go after and seek after this main purpose of life, the idea of seeking his kingdom, giving our life to him, we end up, by default, following a shadow mission that pushes us and leads us down paths that always leads in isolation, separation, sometimes even destruction. You know, it's amazing to me that when I understand and walk down that path of this mission that is seeking God's kingdom first, everything else that is important to me gets in line in its proper place. But when I start to pursue something that's different than that, it gets out of whack. And I end up saying things and doing things that cause pain. Pain to me, pain to the people I care about the most. It's the idea of knowing who you are and what you're called to do. And what the scriptures say over and over and over is when we give our life to this one Jesus, We're adopted, incorporated in, grafted in to God's family. And you live with that purpose. And that has a way of making everything else line up in an appropriate place. And we actually end up experiencing joy. Now in the movie, Jack Campbell has a dream. It's a glimpse of what it could be. What if you don't get a dream or a glimpse? What are you going to do? I know what some will say. They said it to Jesus, and I've heard them say it to me over and over and over. Preacher, in a little bit, I'll seek after it. Just give me some time. In maybe tomorrow. Maybe next year. That's it. Next year. When it's easier. Let me finish this for a while. And when I have a little bit more time, or maybe after I've accomplished a little bit more, then it'll be right for me. I hear that all the time. Some will say, Shane, I'm just too old or too young, or I don't have enough experience yet, or, you know, I'll never forget when Brooke and I were serving in outside of Cordial, Georgia, in this tiny little place called Vienna. There was this young couple about the same age as Brooke and myself, and they had their firstborn about the time that we had our firstborn. And so naturally, we there was a friendship that was created, and it wasn't long before we got to know them and got to know their larger family. I'll never forget this woman's father. He lived in a completely different city in another state. He also was not a nice person in every way that you could imagine. He wasn't nice that way. And if you look at the whole of his life, probably for about 9/10 of his life, he lived it that way. And then late in his life, he ended up going to talk to his minister. He wasn't even part of a church. He sort of just pushed his way in there. And little by little, he gave his life to this Jesus. And it ended up changing him from the inside out. See, that's how change works. Now, it wasn't long after he did that he died. And so if you look at the entirety of his life, for 9/10, maybe 9.5, he spent his life one way, and it was just a tiny fraction of time that he lived it differently. You know what people in his community remember? That tiny fraction of time. You know, in a few months, we'll get close to Easter. And so some of the scriptures that we'll read will have to do with Jesus, particularly his death. Do you know he was crucified between two people? What do we know about one of them? Really nothing. Other than for maybe a few minutes, maybe a few hours, he looks at him who's in the middle and says, "Will you remember me when you come into your kingdom?" That's his legacy. I don't know if you'll get a glimpse of what the next few days or years of your life will ever be. But I can tell you this, if you're waiting for the planets to align, that might not happen. You know, when Jesus begins his ministry, he says the kingdom of God is at hand. He says, repent and believe the good news. And what's not translated well from Greek into English is that it's an imperative. It's with urgency. It's not waiting for that day. Good old Jack Campbell gets a glimpse. I hope we all do. But we might not. And how terrible it would be to sacrifice ourselves and the people most dear to us because we're chasing something that we're blind to. And for some of us, you get to the end, and it might be too late. Today's the day. Not tomorrow. Not next week. Not next year. The kingdom of God in Jesus Christ, that's what incarnation is about, is at hand. Receive the good news. So may it be for you, my dear friends. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let us pray. Oh God, you know who we are. You know our struggles. You know the fears that we fight that are on the outside and the inside of us. In a way that Jesus was able to speak into somebody's time and space. And everything else could become crystal clear. Do that again for us this morning, we pray. Grant us grace and grant us the courage to follow. This we pray in the name of Christ. Amen. You'll find our hymn of consecration. It's hymn number 245, the first Noel. We invite you to stand as you're able as we sing this hymn together. Hymn number 245. Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore.